focused on the most important business we ever partake in as a church, the number one duty of being your people, and that is worshiping you. God, as we worship you with your songs of praise sang in this place, as we worship you through your word read and proclaimed, as we worship you around your table, we ask that the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts, the attitudes of our lives would be pleasing to you, O God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. God, send your Spirit among us in this time, we pray. In the name of Jesus our Lord, amen.
Amen.
To the land,
all the bountiful
but enough, an angel's bride. Holy, all creation cries. Holy, you're lifted high. Holy, holy forever.
Yeah. Today I'll be reading Mark 2. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. And honor your father and mother." He said to them, "Teacher, I have kept all these things since my youth." Jesus, looking at them, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard will it be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God?" And the disciples were perplexed at the words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, For mortals is this as impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mothers or fathers or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of good news, who will not receive 100-fold in this age houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning. How is everybody this morning? Good. So that was a really long scripture reading, wasn't it? Yeah. But it said a lot of really good things. So do y'all have things at your house, like a game or a toy or a doll? You do? Oh, okay.
I have two games.
And you like them, don't you? Okay, so we all have stuff we like at home, and we can all say that we appreciate them and we like them, and it would be really hard for us to give it up. If somebody came to you and said, "Look, I want all your stuff. You need to just give it to me." Like, what? What, but I used my allowance, or my grandpa gave this to me, or Mimi gave it to me, or whatever the case might be, you'd probably be upset if they asked you to do that. But those are just things. They're just things. So what we have to remember is that Jesus is the most important thing. And if we don't have him, we don't have anything. So all those sayings, books, games, dolls, toys, don't mean anything. Because in part of that scripture, what did Jesus say? Do y'all know what a sewing needle is? See that string coming from it, that thread? Look how small that opening is. Jesus said it would be easier to get this camel through that little bitty hole than for someone who hangs on to their possessions and doesn't let go of them and follows him. So that really makes us think, this camel's not going through that hole. That's not going to happen, right? But Jesus said it'd be easier for that to happen than for somebody who had hung on to all of their worldly possessions to enter the kingdom of God. So what we have to remember is that Jesus is what?
God.
He is God. He's the most important thing above everything else. Okay, let's say a prayer. Dear Lord, we love these precious children, and we are so thankful that they are able to hear your scripture and follow your words. And we know, dear Lord, somewhere down in there, they would give it all up for you. So we pray that you keep and watch them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks, guys.
This morning, bringing all of our human stuff with us, the things for which we are thankful and the things for which we cry out, God, help us. We're going to take all of that to our Lord right now in this time, and you know how we're going to do it. You're going to have a time of silent prayer, and then I will lift up a prayer on our behalf as best I can. Church, let's go to God in prayer. Thank you. O God of immeasurable grandeur, of unapproachable holiness, of justice beyond any concept of human perfection, O God, we offer our humble praise. And God, we come amazed. The you who sits enthroned above all that was or is or ever will be bends your ear to hear your children. The you invite us to approach you here in this your house. That you call us your own and you make us a family. Oh God, we come giving you thanks, O Lord, for the many blessings with which we have been encountered, God, for cool mornings and the changing of seasons, for the smiles and laughter of children, for a good meal shared among friends, O God, help us to never take those small blessings for granted. For not only are you the God of the universe, but you are the God of every small, beautiful, wonderful moment. Oh God, we come before you thankful that you indeed are good and confessing, oh God, that we are not. Oh God, in your word we see a young man who asks, what must I do to inherit eternal life? God, we come before you giving thanks that what must be done was done for us. We come before you asking for your help in living as those who have been given eternal life. Of living as ambassadors of your kingdom that does not work by this world's standard. So God, in this time and space, through your word, work upon our hearts and our lives. Make us more like your Son, our Lord. Help us to go forth bearing witness to what you have done in our lives, in our families, and in our community. Oh God, we come before you now asking you to hear the needs of all these individual lives represented here. God, we come before you asking for healing for bodies, healing and wholeness of mind and spirit, healing in families, healing in the daily situations and struggles of life. And while we wait and while we trust in your sovereign hand, oh God, may we take the next step. In whatever is going on in body, in relationship, in situation, may we take our next steps in faith, in boldness, knowing that you indeed hold our future. God, we come before you now lifting up the big needs of our world, being reminded that despite our best efforts, we are still frail creatures. Oh God, we come before you lifting up those in the path of this enormous hurricane. For we have already heard of lives lost and thousands upon thousands displaced. Oh God, who made both mankind and nature itself. Oh God, put a hedge of protection around those in its path. Oh God, we come before you lifting up our needs and also asking you to forgive us for all the things in which we put between you and us, for the things we will not lay down and set aside to be better disciples. Oh God, wrench them from our hearts and our hands. Oh God, help us to be children filled with repentance. Help us to go forth as disciples living the work of repentance. For God, we are yours not by our goodness, but by your grace. So God, thank you. God, help us. God, change us. And when we go forth, God, lead us. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, we pray. Amen. So to all my second service people, y'all are kind of, well, getting the rough draft this morning, the unedited director's cut, if you will. And if you're a second service person, find a first service person and thank them for getting the rough draft every Sunday. Because they get it, and I watch faces, and I talk to a couple of trusted plants. Okay, I talked to Elizabeth in between services. And then I sit there and I scratch out what didn't work, or I highlight what I forgot. But today, friends, we're doing it live.
And friends, we're going into a passage that we looked at just a few months back, the story of the rich young ruler. When we went through Mark's gospel, kind of piece by piece, we looked at it, but we just had to dig back into it because no kind of discussion on passages that make us uncomfortable is complete without. And I think it's well justified, that statement, that this is uncomfortable for everyone. One, because even within the passage, it's making people uncomfortable because the disciples start bellyaching immediately. I think it's also easy to say it's an uncomfortable teaching because of how many different cop-outs, trying to wiggle out, trying to shift the blame in this passage we see everywhere we look, and it's been going on for hundreds of years. I know I mentioned when we talked about this passage a few months back, there have been myriad and sundry efforts to make the camel smaller and the eye of the needle bigger. People saying, well, there's an eye of a needle in Jerusalem. It's a certain gate that a camel laden with goods cannot get through. But if the camel shucks its goods, gets on its knees, then it can pass through. Funny, no gate like that has ever been found. Also funny that that legend kind of came about in the Middle Ages when the clergy was united with the government and overall very, very rich. Funny how rumors begin. There have been so many efforts to wrangle out and go, well, he's only talking to the rich and that ain't us. Well, he's only talking to the young and that ain't me. Well, he's only talking to... This is an uncomfortable teaching that really, if we let it, should offend most all of us equally, should inspire most all of us, and, well, leave us squirming a little bit. Because friends, no matter how we try to wiggle out from under it, I think we're all going to find in this passage, all of us camels are going to get stuck no matter how we suck it in. And we're going to talk at the ways we've made light of this. We're going to talk the verse by verse, some really interesting things about this. But to sum it all up, in case you zone out smelling delicious hamburgers, it is impossible to save ourselves. Thankfully, we don't have to. But friends, the gospel is not about what you must do to be saved. That's the good news. The bad news is it's all about what you're going to do because of it. That's kind of at the core of this and what Jesus gets to, and also Jesus reminds us, as you get closer to Him, He has this uncanny way of looking at you and knowing what your one thing you don't want Him to touch is and going right where you don't want Him to. So this passage starts off with Jesus on a journey. It's in the Gospel of Mark. We've been in Luke and John for a bit, but Jesus is on a journey probably towards Jerusalem because it's right at that turning point in Mark's gospel. Also, to start it off, this passage, this story happens in all three synoptic gospels. Matthew, Mark, and Luke. That's the other way we can tell it made people really uncomfortable is when disciples started writing this stuff down, this stood out. If this made it in three out of the four gospels, you know it was a big deal to the original audience. So Jesus is on a journey, and this young man comes running up to him. Here's what's so funny about how the Gospels become common knowledge. How do we describe the man? The story of the rich young ruler. Here's what's funny. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all say he's rich. Only Matthew says he's young, and only Luke says he's a ruler, or some mix thereof. We take them all together and go, well, he's rich, young, and a ruler. But you get one in each, pretty much. This man comes up to Jesus, and part of the reason this makes me uncomfortable is I want to love this rich young ruler. Because I gotta tell you, this guy is doing everything right. Jesus did not go looking for him. Jesus is just about his business, and this young man runs to Jesus, gets on his knees, humbles himself in spite of his position or his prestige or a dollar amount. He humbles himself and says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And while we all know from a Reformed theology perspective, we cannot earn salvation. We cannot earn the grace given to us on the cross. But I love that this young man says, I am ready to get to work, but he also says, inherit eternal life. What can I do so that God will give me this gift? Theologically, he's really there. He's really asking a question ahead of his time. I want this free gift that the Father will leave to me. What do I need to do? Also, anybody who's in a church, this man is the dream candidate. This man is the dream visitor. And I think that's why it makes us so uncomfortable, is because this guy would have been an asset to the disciples. What do all churches want more of? More young families. Every church I've ever gone into, ever talked to, ever worked at, we need more young folk. What does every church also need? Big givers, right? What does every church and every community want? They want movers and shakers too. They want to boost the church's name. The disciples are probably looking and seeing, wow, this is really going to help us out. He's rich, he's young, he's powerful. He's a mover and shaker in the community. This is the dream guy every church, every movement, every organization, every civic club wants to walk through their doors. And he comes in, gets on his knees, and says, good teacher, what must I do to receive the gift from the Father? And Jesus' first response catches us and him off guard. Why do you call me good? No one is good but God. There's two things to that that are really interesting. One is, we know what Jesus is doing. He is turning all the glory, all the attention back to the Father. He's saying, you're experiencing me man to man. I want you to point your eyes to the Father. If you're looking at goodness, look above. Because this is the fully human Jesus talking. But also, I think it is Jesus asking a question of, do you know what you are implying? He says, only God is good, but you have called me good teacher. This man may actually be making the earliest confession of faith that Christ is the Messiah. By him attributing this God alone quality to Jesus. Him saying, no, I am prostrate before you asking you for direction because you are the good teacher. It's almost as though Jesus is not only pointing the attention to the Father for the crowd around, but also to this man saying, who told you that? Do you know what you are saying? God alone is good, and yet you have just called me good. Did you hear something I haven't said yet? Do you know something these other disciples don't know? It holds within it an element of a confession of faith. Then Jesus reminds him and us, Jesus didn't drop down onto a blank slate in terms of righteousness and morals and ethics. He goes, keep the law. We sometimes as Christians tend to forget that Jesus came on the heels and in the middle of a rich, vibrant life of faith. That's why I love on Wednesday nights that we are digging into that minutia of the law stuff, because we're seeing kind of the path for righteousness, for obedience, for faithfulness that began so many generations before what we so often proclaim. Jesus tells him, you want to be righteous? You know how to be righteous. You're God's people. And you're somebody among them. Keep the law. And the different Gospels have a little different take on which ones Jesus quotes, but pretty much he names like three of the Ten Commandments and maybe one more. Honor your father and mother. Don't lie. Don't steal. Don't commit adultery. Don't swindle a neighbor. Sometimes he quotes the greatest commandment in a couple of the Gospels. Love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as self. So Jesus tells him, you want to know how to be righteous? I can tell you how to be righteous, but you already know. And then here's the first part where I begin to take a bone of contention with the young man. All of these I have kept since my youth. Anybody else want to stand by that statement in front of Jesus? Yeah, me neither. Says, Jesus, be righteous according to the law. I've got it. But even that means so much more than just that this kid is being arrogant. What it means is, by the rule of his day, he had checked every box. By the rule of his day, he had offered, he had tithed, he had served, he had helped. He had not swindled. He was faithful. He was doing all of the things that his society said, do this to be a righteous, upstanding young man. And he did it in spades. And yet, look, he still knew something was missing. That is one thing we miss to his credit. Even though he might have come in with a little bit of a cocky statement, God bless those who have checked all the boxes and still know without Jesus something is missing. He says, I've kept all these. Jesus says, well, there's one thing. There's one thing alone you can do. You can sell everything, give the money to the poor, and follow me. Here's how this makes us real uncomfortable in two ways. One, when Jesus talks in the realm of interpersonal communications, of morals, of ethics, of belief, those are all things you can kind of argue about because they're subjective. This isn't. Here, Jesus looks a man square in the face and gives him a three-step order of operations. Sell your stuff, give the money, and come on. Whoa. It's uncomfortable because Jesus is eerily specific and pointed to the man. He tells him exactly, and I love that as a person of faith because I don't know how many times I have prayed and cried out, Jesus, just tell me what you want me to do. Just show me, God, what you want me to do. And this reminds me, sometimes be careful what you ask for, Christian. It also makes us uncomfortable because what he tells the man to do is radical. Then, now, anytime, shoot. It's one thing when Jesus gets into the word you're supposed to be speaking, or the heart, or the belief, or the relationships, but the idea of Jesus sticking his hand in your pocket, getting out your wallet, especially with what groceries cost these days. And of course, the young man doesn't have a happy ending, just according to the text, does he? Says he left grieving because he had much. And this is the part where a lot of times the cop-out of this is, well, his real sin wasn't having the money, it was idolatry. Because Jesus told him, keep all the commandments. The young man said, I have. And Jesus pointed out that, you know, you do have another God before me. And friends, that is very true. I do think that you're not as righteous as maybe you think you are is a real valid, salient point here in this passage. But even that we use to go, man, this story's his problem, not mine. He had an idol, I don't. If Jesus found his, he'll find yours too. So the young man leaves and the disciples are standing around, and obviously this is harsh to them. And they're talking, and then Jesus sees it and uses it as a teaching moment. A key theme in the Gospel of Mark is that Jesus knows what people are thinking. You see that a lot in Mark's Gospel. And he goes, how hard to get in the kingdom of heaven. How hard for a rich man to get into the kingdom of heaven. Challenging their idea that if everything comes from God, truly, those who have been blessed with worldly goods are probably closer to God. That was really the way they looked at their cosmos in the time. And here Jesus threatens the way they look at the world working and goes, easier for a camel to get through the eye of a needle, and whether that is the unburdened camel at the gate or the needle and the camel, which I think it is, Jesus points out something to them that made them very upset. The people you think are automatically the recipients of God's blessing, the people you think, well, man, they must have done something right to have what they have, that's no guarantee. And then when they look at this young man who had done everything right, who comes to Jesus, falls down at his feet and says, what must I do? And then Jesus pointed out his one idol. And the man leaves dejected and grieving. That had to have the disciples looking in the mirror going, are we next? If this young man who has everything going for him can't make the cut, am I an imposter in disciples' clothing? Anybody ever feel like that as a Christian? Me too. So then Peter speaks up. They begin to go, then who can be saved to each other? And then Jesus goes, that's the neat part. You can't. With man, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. And friends, in this way, this passage definitely points to grace, absolutely 100%. It is a reminder that you can't do anything to be saved. It's all about what you do about being saved, because you are saved. Yes, Jesus points this all back to grace, but yet, even here, friends, we try to wiggle out from the discomfort of this passage at our peril. We just go, oh, he pointed out that young man's imperfection because it's all about grace. So, no, we're fine. Don't think so. The disciples then get together and they're going over this, and Peter speaks up and he does what disciples always do. Let me take his problem and make it about me. But Jesus, we have given up everything to follow you. Big theme in all the Gospels, the disciples, except for the one writing and talking usually, is always getting a little selfish, wanting to lift themselves up. They go, but Jesus, we've given up everything to follow you. And Jesus says, and which one of you aren't going to get back 100-fold? And here's the part that's really fun. He goes, anybody who's given up family, they're going to get a new one in this life. And in some ways, I've seen that to be true, right? The church is a great family. And then he says, those who've given up houses, you're going to get more back in this life, not just in the next. I don't know about that, but there's something wonderful about being a follower of Christ. Home is wherever he is. Then he tells them, you know, and fields and all of that. But then he goes, and persecutions, all 100-fold. He's doing this thing where he is breaking down the disciples' idea that hard times are the result of God's retribution and riches are the result of God's blessing. Jesus is reminding them, in this world, the sun rises and sets on the good and the bad. The rain falls on the good and the evil. And you know what? God's blessing will still follow you when you're a Christian. You will have a new family. You will have new places to call home. You will be blessed and taken care of. But friend, also in the same way you had bad days before, you're going to have bad days now. And now, not just because of who you are, but because of who I am. It's a hard, hard word. And then he tells them, this whole thing that you think the way the world works ain't the way the Father's kingdom will work. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. You saw a man who you would call number one, a VIP, a celebrity. Give him the good seat. And he walked away dejected. Y'all are a bunch of nobodies that I'm trying to make into a somebody, but you are trying to be a somebody like that, not like me. The first shall be last, as the last shall be first. Friends, as disciples, be careful of what our metric for success is. And that's where our passage ends, and there's just no good way to get comfortable with it. But one, it stands that there is nothing we can put between us and God if we want to be His disciple. There is nothing to which we can hold so dear that Jesus will not call you on the mat for it. So often I have compared the life of discipleship to having company coming over to your house. Because when that happens, what do? We clean everything, but if we're honest, there's still that one closet you don't want them to open. Or maybe it's even a bedroom, you're like, just shuffle all the junk into there. Well, Jesus is the house guest, so when he doesn't go to the kitchen, he doesn't even stop at the bathroom, he will walk right to that closet or that room and go, let me in there. And friends, if you've done this disciple thing for a while, you know it to be true. Friends, expect to be uncomfortable as followers of Christ. Expect that whether it's the money, whether it's ego, whether it's sense of security, whether it is anything at all, that you go, Jesus, take it all from me, but not that. That but not that is right where He is going. And that's what He does right here. And in the midst of it, He reminds the disciples that even though you're following Him, even though you are on the journey and you have given up so much, never forget that you can be wrong too. They are still using the world's metric for success as their own. They are still going, how can I save myself? And Jesus has to remind them time again, that's the neat part, you can't. Now live like it. And then finally, I think this speaks to us in one last way because of one really weird part of this story. The one thing that sets Mark's gospel apart from the other accounts, they're all remarkably similar except for one little phrase, and it stands out as very odd. When Jesus replies to the young man, He says, He loved him and then told him, sell everything, give the money away, and follow me. Mark is the only gospel that mentions Jesus said what He said because He loved that man. That unknown, unnamed man. Jesus looked and He was not harsh because He's trying to put a barrier to the table or to the family. He's not harsh because Jesus is controlling. He was harsh in that moment and said, you've got to lay down that idol, because He looked at him and said, I love you so much, I can't let you tote that. But why might that be? There's been a lot of talk about it. Why does Mark pick that out and none of the others? How could Mark know Jesus looked at this man and loved him when Luke and Matthew didn't? Because Mark knew the man. There's a lot of tradition and argument and scholars who make the point that for Mark to be able to say he loved the rich young ruler, he either has to be the rich young ruler, or he has to know him personally. And we know Mark in the book of Acts, his mother is wealthy, wealthy. She hosts the disciples. She is a benefactor of the church. His uncle or cousin, depending on what you translate, is Barnabas, who goes on with Saul, later Paul, to do missionary work all around. This guy is pedigree both in terms of the church and Judaism. He also is filthy rich. So isn't it interesting that the story of the rich young ruler in Mark contains him talking as though he knows the man? And if he knows the man, or was the man, or Barnabas, his relative, was the man, that means that's not the end of the story. And what he left grieving was not just the command, but he was grieving because he goes, I gotta sell all this stuff. And he left grieving, but at some point there is a real possibility that man gave it away, that man came to faith, that man laid down his idol and came back. So friends, I don't know how many times in your life or our lives we have run away with that one thing we can't let go. That one thing, that one door we didn't want Jesus to open, that one shadow we didn't want Him to shine a light into, that one thing I don't want to hand over to Him. But friends, if there is some truth to what these scholars are saying, it is never, ever too late. And I know if you still have breath in your lungs, for you, it is never too late. So as we go forth, may we lay down anything that stands between us and Him, anything that hinders our call to discipleship, and may we live a life of faith that doesn't seek to be comfortable, but that expects the gospel and the Spirit and the community to make us uncomfortable, so that it makes us more like Him. Amen.
Sing, let us break bread together.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees.
Here at this table, we are once again and always reminded we can do nothing to save ourselves. Here we are reminded of what He did to save us, and one of the ways we live about it is to remember Him the way He commands disciples to do. Here we remember how Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took the bread and He broke it and said, "This is My body, broken for you. Take, eat this in remembrance of Me." In the same way, He took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood, poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Take, drink in remembrance of Me." Sisters and brothers, every time we come to this table eating this bread and drinking this cup, we proclaim His life, death, and resurrection until He comes again.
Heavenly Father, let us enter the kingdom of heaven by keeping the commandments and supporting the poor. As we partake of these emblems, we ask for salvation, because with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Let us always follow You. Now let us pray the prayer He taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This table is not First Christian Church's table. It is not a Disciples of Christ table. It is the Lord's table. All who seek Christ are welcome and encouraged to partake. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
of our financial blessings to the one who gave it to us, who gave us all. Open your hearts to the poor and now and support to God's wishes. Loving Father, it is with grateful hearts we return a portion of your blessings to you. May you bless them and to the furthering of your kingdom here on earth. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. In our relationship with Christ, it is He who gets us through the eye of the needle. Then it is we who decide what we're going to do about it. If you have experienced today that you have been given new life and would like to confess that through confessing the faith for the first time, or if you would like to join with this worshiping body, the table of grace is open during the hymn of invitation.
And they'll know.
peace with this benediction, but don't go far. We'll be eating in a moment. As you go forth, may God's grace go before you and attend to you. May the Holy Spirit never let us get too comfortable in following after Christ. And in all things, may we lay aside whatever hinders us in pursuing Him. Go in peace. Amen. Amen.